everybody ready for the Mind Dog to make it to the show?
And welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here, as always. Having a little trouble with the lips here today. Appreciate you coming today. We're going to take another look at the concept of evil robots and AI taking over the world, or maybe not. This time, from more of a scientific perspective, earlier in the week, we were talking about it from a theologian. perspective when a pastor who has written a book about the subject was on, and today we have more of a scientific look with a guy who has been studying AI and computer intelligence, computers, and their impact on the world since 1979. So I think he's got a pretty good handle on the subject. He's written a book called Evil Robots, Killer Computers, and Other Myths, The Truth About AI and the Future of Humanity. So we'll be talking to him in just one moment. Before I bring him in, I need to quickly introduce you to our sponsors today. Today's show is brought to you by audiobooksnow.com. And I'm not sure if this particular book is available on audiobook yet, but you know about the convenience of audiobooks, and you know that you can get audiobooks just about anywhere on the web right now. So why audiobooksnow.com? What makes them different? Well, the answer is simple. Price point. Audiobooks Now Club pricing plan is simply the best deal on audiobooks you'll find. It offers the savings and flexibility not found anywhere else with their save on everything discounts, rollovers, exclusive offers, loyalty program, incredible selection, and cancel anytime policy. It simply cannot be beat. Plus, get a free premium audiobook on select titles when you click the link in the description right now. And also, you're going to start a 30-day free trial of the club membership plan, and it's normally $4.99 a month. You have to try completely free for 30 days. If you're not happy anytime, you just cancel. You won't be billed a thing for the audio for the club pricing plan. Now, audiobooks now, you save on every audiobook you purchase. They do not use gimmicky credits to hide their true costs. Whether you want to save big through the club pricing plan or simply purchase at their everyday low prices, they offer the lowest prices anywhere on audiobooks that you'll find. They offer one of the largest selections on audiobooks anywhere. You can download or stream to your audiobooks through your website or free apps, all available on the website. Click the link in the description. I do appreciate you patronizing our sponsors. Now, my intro here is kind of long, but probably the longest we've ever had, and so bear with me. It's worth listening to because it's an impressive little bit of a preview resume. Steve Shwartz is my guest today. Steve has received his PhD from Johns Hopkins University in Cognitive Science, where he began his AI research and also taught statistics at Towson State University. After receiving his PhD in 1979, AI pioneer Roger Schank, I hope I get that right, invited Steve to join the Yale University faculty as a postdoctoral researcher in computer science. In 1981, Roger asked Steve to help him start one of the first AI companies, Cognitive Systems, which progressed it to public offering in 1986. Steve then started Esperant, which produced one of the leading business intelligence products of the 1990s. During the 1980s, Steve published 35 articles and a book on AI, spoke many AI conferences, and received two commercial patents on AI. As the AI winter of the 1990s set in, which I need to ask him about what that means, Steve transitioned into a career as a successful serial software entrepreneur and investor, and created several companies that were either acquired or had public offerings. He tries to use his unique perspective as an AI researcher and a statistician to both explain how AI works in simple terms, to explain why people shouldn't worry about intelligent robots taking over the world, although we will, and to explain why the steps we need to take as a society to minimize the negative impacts of AI and maximize the positive impacts. Ladies and gentlemen, please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Steve Shwartz to the Mind Dog TV podcast. Steve, welcome.
Hey, thank you, man, and thanks for having me.
It's my pleasure to have you and my privilege to have you. And this is a subject we've talked about this week. It started with simulation theory. I'm not sure how much you know about that stuff, but I've been trying to get physicists on to talk about simulation theory and haven't had much luck at all. So the best I could do was get a guy I found on Facebook who actually knows a little bit about it and is a believer in it. But it went to the point of artificial intelligence because the belief in simulation theory is about a creator who is a computer geek, I guess, and simulating the whole world. But the very next day, I had a pastor on who has written a book about this subject. He also comes, oddly enough, as a theologian, he comes from a perspective of we don't need to be that worried about it as well, which is surprising to me because I would think most of the religious people would be on the side of this is a bad thing. So I appreciate your perspective here, and I'm hoping that we can learn something, but I'm not optimistic that you're going to make people not nervous about this because it's something that we've been conditioned for 60 or my whole life at least now 60 years or more through television, movies, books, and pop culture in general is that someday Hal is going to take over and run the world. So give me why we shouldn't worry as a starter point.
Sure. So, and you, I hope you'll tell me, Matt, at the end of the podcast, if you're still worried about Hal.
Okay.
So, you know, a lot of people are worried. You know, they've seen the TV series Westworld, where there are human-like androids. You can't tell the difference between the androids and the humans. They saw 2001, the Arthur C. Clarke movie that you're talking about, where there was a computer that ran the ship and, you know, talked to the astronauts just like a person. We've seen the Terminator movie, the Arnold Schwarzenegger movie with the evil Terminator, tried to exterminate humanity. And then, you know, that's on the tail of a lot of really great progress in AI. So because of AI, we can have our smartphones label the pictures we take with the names of the people in the pictures. We can translate languages. We go to a web page in a foreign language, we click a button and all of a sudden it's in English. And on and on, you know, we're making progress in medicine, and AI is really, really one achievement after the next. And, you know, so because of both of those things, people wonder where it will all lead. And so you naturally worry about these intelligent robots. And, you know, there are some well-known people who put gasoline on the fire. Elon Musk constantly says that AI is the biggest existential risk to humanity. And the late physicist Stephen Hawking made a similar point. So that's what people are worried about. The reality is nobody has a clue how to build a truly intelligent robot. And all of the amazing breakthroughs that we've seen in AI are really relatively simple technology with no intelligence at all.
Well, I have to play the devil's advocate here. Not that I'm on the fence. I'm really curious and want to learn, but the argument is not so much the Hal scene, because, you know, I think people are intelligent enough to understand a dramatization or something that is put in there for dramatic effect of this computer that just refuses to take orders now, and I'm going to give the orders and I have the ability to lock you out of a spaceship or whatever. That I think people realize that is contrived through for dramatic purposes and dramatic effect. But as we were talking the other day, and I know this is true, robots are not always the way we characterize them in the movies. They're not always humanoids. And so as a marketing director for a period of time, I worked for a food packaging machine company, that build machines that package food. And those are robots, even though they don't look like humans in any way. They're robotic and intelligent, somewhat intelligent, understanding machines that have a complete function. But when they break down and have a problem, human the analogy was that humans become the slaves to the machines right now. The humans are putting in more time serving the machines than necessary the machines serving the humans. And that is a it's kind of on the edge of where we're talking about, because the real fear is that someday the robots will take over and we will become slaves to them. And in some small aspect of that, when we see they have problems, that has been the case in manufacturing. No? Am I completely off base there?
Well, the robots in manufacturing have started to do a lot of jobs, but those robots are completely unintelligent. They can't have a real conversation with you. They can't think and reason in any real sense. They're programmed to do one very specific task. You know, if you go into a factory and you see a robot arm that just is constantly painting the same spot on the next automobile, or, you know, banging a nail in for somewhere, you know, usually there's a big red sign that says, you know, don't cross the red line or the robot arm might hit you. You know, nobody thinks of those as intelligent.
No.
But that's the level of intelligence of all the robots that are in factories today.
Not quite, though. If I may, I'm sorry to interrupt, but with the food packaging machines, they were taking raw product, measuring it, putting it on, I think, to be washed, measured, put into a container. Another thing would come across and seal it. Then they have another part of the same machine coming in to measure the oxygen and hydrogen and all the different gas, nitrogen that are in the package. And then the machine would report and say, there's a problem with this food. Might be a little past ripe or past its best state or whatever, and the oxygen and hydrogen level is this. So it is communicating and doing far more than just one simple task. This is a very set of complex tasks that, you know, but in some way it was communicating back to the operator exactly what was going on and if there were problems and all that stuff. So
absolutely. So let's talk about how that robot works. So everything that robot does, except one piece, you don't need AI for. You just need conventional software where a programmer writes explicit instructions that tells the robot exactly what to do. You know, how to measure something, what to say if a value is over a certain threshold, and so forth. The AI in that particular robot is in the computer vision, the ability to find the parts it's looking for by interpreting what comes in through the camera lens.
Right.
And that part is AI. And let's talk about how that particular piece of AI works. So let's say you want to build a piece of AI that can recognize and distinguish between five different parts in a factory. Okay. What you will do is you'll create a database of examples of those five parts. You know, maybe you'll have 10,000 of each part. You'll mix them all up. And along with the picture of each part, you'll say there'll be a label. This is part one, or this is whatever it is. This is part one, this is part two, this is part three, this is part four. And then you feed all that data into an AI algorithm that learns how to take an image and classify it as part one through five. Okay? And once it's done doing that, now it can take images that weren't in the training database, and it can classify those as parts one through five. So it can take new ones, and that's essential because on the factory floor, it's never seen any of those exact parts. But that's the only thing that piece of AI can do. It can't distinguish between a dog and a cat. It can't have a conversation with you. It can't do anything else. It's just a stupid algorithm. It was learned with AI, and it's impressive that AI can do that, but there's no intelligence there.
Right. Okay, so I'm with you now, and I can actually probably give you my answer now that I'm not nervous about Hal taking over the world based on just already what you've laid out on that. But here's my but. We look at how quickly things have evolved from the very first computers that were as big as a house that would just be able to give you a simple word processor, a readout of something or something like that, and use the tapes and all that stuff, to where we are today. So looking not just 10, 20 years down the road, but say 100 years down the road, we're looking at the possibility that there will be real intelligence, or am I just being like a science fiction fantasy when I think that way?
I think it's fantasy, but there are some people that make that argument. And here's the problem with that argument. 50 years ago, you had computers that did word processing that were really, really primitive compared to today. I don't have the statistics. Let's say they're today's computers are a million times faster. It's probably more than that, right?
Right.
But if you put the same word processing program on that slow computer and today's fast computer, the only thing it can do is word processing. Now, it'll do it word processing fast on one machine, and on the older machine, it'll take forever to open up the document, but it still will only be able to do the word processing that you programmed into it. Now, let's look 50 years in the future. Now, say we have a computer that's 50 million times faster and more powerful than today's computer. And you put that word processing program on the computer, and that's the only thing you put on it. Guess what? The only thing that really fast computer can do is word processing.
Right. Okay. I kind of get where you're going with that, but have there not been advances in what looks like human intelligence, which is what artificial intelligence is? It's mocking human intelligence. Have there not been some that are beyond that from the days of that initial really clunky IBM computer that was as big as a house and required lots of tapes and all that stuff to do simple word processing? Have there not been advances that look like intelligence?
In word processing?
In computers and robots in general from that time.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, look at facial recognition.
Right.
We have computers that can look at a picture and say, yeah, that's a picture of Matt. That's a picture of Steve. That's a picture of my daughter, Becky.
Right.
That's amazing. Let's talk about what's under the hood, though. What's amazing is that you can take such simple technology and produce something that seems so intelligent. So let's talk about how facial recognition works. You start with a database of, in this case, probably millions of examples of people's faces and their names. You feed those million images to an AI system, and it will learn a function. You probably remember functions from high school.
Right.
Centigrade is 5/9 of Fahrenheit minus 32. That's right. A function. There's right. No intelligence in that function. The AI system will learn a function very much like that temperature conversion function, more complicated, but it'll be just a function. And all it can do is take an image and put a name next to the image. But that's all you need. And it seems really, really smart. But all it is one function, and that's the only thing it can do. It can't tell a dog from a cat. It can't have a conversation with you. You look at machine translation, that translating web pages into foreign languages, exactly the same thing.
Right. So
medical diagnosis, exactly the same thing.
Where you started, though, you said, let's take a look under the hood. And I think that's the problem here. Most people don't know exactly the workings, the inner workings of this stuff. And so when we see social media, delivering advertising based on what we were thinking about, or which is really weird. But obviously, it's usually on our browser history. But this conversation came up the other day in that there have been times where I haven't had any browser history, just having a discussion about something, and all of a sudden I'm seeing ads about it. Now, that could be a psychological, you know, that whole, I forget the psychological term, but when you buy a new car, all of a sudden you're seeing that car anywhere, maybe because you were talking about it, and now you're seeing an ad, you're making that association. Could be that, but it happens a lot. And so, but when we see general that, you know, Facebook or Twitter is showing us ads relevant to what we were really interested in this moment, and we don't understand the inner workings, you can understand how people can get a little bit frightened by that technology and worried. Yes?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I don't get frightened or worried, but I get annoyed.
Yeah. But you know the inner workings. Again, I'm coming back to this point where you said, let's look under the hood. Most people have no understanding of how under the hood works. And to us, it's like fire without knowing how fire is created. Like,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So let's talk about how those work. And it's the same exact technology that was behind that Cambridge Analytica debacle.
Right.
If you remember it. And it all started with a psychologist who decided to, and I don't know if I have this exactly right, to study whether they could take a Facebook profile and the information in a Facebook profile and predict personality types and political leanings and so forth. And they would do it exactly the way I was talking about. They build a big database of examples. You know, here are the things in the Facebook profile: Republican, Democrat, communist, you know, and so forth. And they started creating these functions to be able to predict from the Facebook profile somebody's leanings. And you start doing this with Facebook and Twitter and social media, and all of a sudden, they ended up with 80 million profiles on people.
Man.
And now when they go to distribute ads or decide what somebody sees on social media, they can use these profiles and give them ads that they think will make the person buy. But it's just, they've just computed these functions that will do it. I mean, it's amazing technology, but there's no intelligence there. It's just ways. And in fact, the way they computed those functions in the Cambridge Analytica case, I was teaching in 1977 at Towson University. It used to be called statistics.
Yeah.
Now it's called artificial intelligence.
Okay.
And you know, today you have much more, you can compute much more complex functions, and you can analyze much larger databases. But it's doing exactly the same thing I was teaching in 1977.
Okay. So here, I don't even know how to really transition this, because the idea that I think you're proposing is that there will never be a humanoid robot that kind of is, and I'm not all that intelligent as me, being able to say, I want to start a podcast and interview people to learn stuff, and I'm going to, and basically you'll be talking to a robot here. It sounds like you're saying that's never going to happen, right?
Yeah. So, you know, never is a little bit, I always hate to say never, you know, right. in 1930 something, Lord Rutherford, who was the first person to, you know, explain how there was a nucleus of an atom and electronics that floated around it, said, we'll never split the atom and harness the electricity. 2 years later, there was the nuclear bomb. You know, I mean, you've got people working today on time travel, warp speed, the fountain of reversing aging. I would never say any of those things will never happen. What I would say is that intelligent robot humanoid is about as likely as time travel, reversing aging, or warp speed.
Okay. Well, that's kind of why I jumped to the conclusion that I could answer your question, because I don't see it happening in my lifetime. So I'm not worried about it.
Right.
Being the selfish guy that I am. We're making this transition here. And I think this is part of the discussion is, even if that never happens, there are human people who are running these computer programs and robots and sort of things that can have malicious or, I want to use the word, evil intent. And we worry about the big corporations which are run by people using these things against us. And is that's part of the worry too. And Lori has a comment I want to just show it because it illustrates that. Messenger on your phone listens. You need to turn it off. The idea that Siri and Alexis and all, I think that's what it's called, right? Alexis, or something like that, the Google version of it, are listening to us at all times, reporting back to that database, which was put together by people, and then manipulating us. Is that part of this conversation or not?
Absolutely. I mean, there are a lot of things that AI can do that should worry us, and maybe we should talk about them. But it's not the intelligence. It's not the, you know, robots are going to take over the world and turn us into pets, and that we don't have to worry about. But there are issues, big issues: discrimination, privacy, safety, military uses. All of those are things we should worry about. But if we got a minute, can we just come back to a minute to the idea of having a conversation with a computer? Because a lot of people are going to listen to this conversation we've just had and say, well, if Steve's saying you can't ever have a conversation with a computer, I talk to Siri every day. What about that?
Right. What about that?
If you look at again, it's amazing technology, but there's no intelligence there. The way all of those programs are written is somebody sits down, and in the case of Alexa, there are over 100,000 companies or people that have developed these little chat abilities. So there's a lot of people working on it, and what they do is they make a list of all the things they want you to be able to say. And for each thing they want you to be able to say, they program the computer how to respond, either by saying something or by running a program. And then they detail every possible way they can think of that you could say each one of those things.
Right. But
and that's how they work.
I'm going to interrupt a lot because that's my nature, and I'm sorry about that. But isn't that the way our brains work too? Aren't our brains essentially a database of responses and conditioned, you know, words that we can reply to a certain words that are fed to us? No, that isn't what our intelligent brains are do as well.
Well, a lot of what you see in when you understand something, you understand a lot about what's not said. You don't just understand the words that are said.
Right.
You make inferences about what hasn't been said. If I tell you, I like apples. Well, you know I'm talking about eating. Well, I never said anything about eating.
Right.
Alexa has no idea that you eat apples.
Gotcha. I get it. So, but again, I keep thinking, you know, not in the next 20 years or 40 years perhaps, but can you see it in the next 100 years? Let's say that we will make that advance. Somebody will create a think, because they created a machine that can beat geniuses at chess or Jeopardy and win in Jeopardy and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Is that intelligence in your view or not?
You know, what started me thinking about writing this book, it started with the IBM Watson computer that beat the two Jeopardy champions. You know, I mean, I watched that. I admit I was rooting for the computer. I was thrilled when it won. And, you know, it could answer all these complex questions. It was amazing. But I knew that under the hood, there was no intelligence there. That what was really happening was, you know, probably this is what I was guessing, that, you know, the computer's matching the words in the question to the words in a massive database of articles that had pulled from the internet and Wikipedia. And in fact, IBM published a series of 12 technical articles where they explained exactly how it worked. And I read them. And I said, yeah, that's kind of what I figured. That's exactly how it worked. Amazing that they could do it, but no intelligence. And then IBM started marketing Watson, started branding themselves as Watson. Watson can think and reason just like a person. Man, that started, that I didn't like. You know, that's to me, that was I didn't like that. And then Microsoft came along and said,
was that false advertising? Is that what that was? Or was it, is that the reason that you were against it?
Well, false advertising is false facts. So IBM made the claims in a way that the facts were correct, but they still misrepresented the truth.
Okay.
That's part of why I used truth in the book title. You know, and then Microsoft did the same thing. We've created a computer program that can read as well as people, that can read better than people. Nothing could be farther from the truth. The fact, yes, they were able to create a program that matched words to words, and on one specific type of test, they got human-level results. But the computer didn't understand any of what it was reading. It was just matching words to answers. I apologize. I forgot where I was going with that.
Well, it's all right. Well, the question here, again, you point out this computer that was... It mocks intelligence by having such a strong database for this one particular task. But what is stopping people from creating a machine that combines those really super powerful database-driven taskings and taking every possible, or not every possible, but many, many, many human-like tasks into one machine with all those lots and lots of databases now for each independent task? Is that intelligence, or is still that part of reasoning missing?
So I'm going to give you two answers to that. First of all, people do a lot more tasks than you really think about. I detailed in my book how just making breakfast might be like 1,000 different tasks. But suppose you did do that. Suppose, you know, you identified 1 billion different tasks that a person can do, and you built an AI system for each one of those tasks. Now your question is, would you have an intelligent machine?
Right.
Well, how's the machine going to know which task to apply to which situation?
Right.
You need intelligence.
Reason, right?
You need intelligence. You really haven't started yet.
Right. Yeah. Is reason beyond the capability of machines? Can machines ever have that, what we call intelligence from the human brain? Can they apply reasoning to things?
So I think it's about as likely as time travel.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, you know, we've been trying to do that. We thought we were going to be able to program computers to reason in the 50s, then again in the 60s, 70s, 80s. We actually skipped the 90s because we.
That's why I wanted to add, because you said the winter of AI in the 90s, yeah. I grabbed that from your website. What does that mean? We stopped doing any research into AI in the 90s?
Yeah. So what happened was, you know, in the 1980s, AI was really hot. It was on the cover of every magazine, Time and Business Week, and, you know, and AI was just over the horizon. And by the end of the 1980s, it had never materialized. You know, we didn't, it hadn't built, you know, usable systems like facial recognition and machine translation. Nothing had happened. And people gave up on it. And in fact, researchers like me, you know, realized it was way, way, way harder than anybody thought, and, you know, kind of gave up in a lot of respects. There was a professor at Berkeley who taught AI. In 1985, he says he had 500 people in his intro to AI class. In 1990, 25.
Wow.
And that became known as the second AI winter. And a similar thing had actually happened towards the end of the 60s, early 70s. So there have been two AI winters, and, you know, people ask if there'll be a third. And the answer, of course, is no, because AI is making such an impact on everybody's lives.
It strikes me as maybe, obviously you being in the field, you would know better than me, but it strikes me that maybe the attention was just diverted away because in the 1990s, it was all about Windows 95 and AOL and people getting online for the first time. So a lot of the attention, a lot of the money was being driven that way. So it might not be that people were necessarily giving up on AI. It's just there was a more lucrative and more pressing, attention-grabbing phenomena that needed the attention of the tech sector of the world. Does that have any validity, that argument?
It's certainly possible. Possible. But it was also true that, you know, AI hadn't gotten anywhere and nobody knew how to make it get anywhere.
Right. Well, we are past the half hour mark, which is where I usually like to do a little plug for the book. The website is airperspectives.aiperspectives.com. It's all one word, and the link will be in the description. I want to show the book cover quickly if we can. That's the book cover right there. It's The Evil Robots, Killer Computers, and Other Myths, The Truth About AI and the Future of Humanity. So we talk about the fears of AI. What are the from your perspective, what are the positive things that we're looking at right now? I mean, obviously manufacturing and in medicine there's some use for it. Where is the biggest plus to humanity as we're seeing it right now with where AI is headed?
You know, it's affecting our lives in so many ways. You know, the biggest impact might yet be in the medical area. There are over 100 AI programs in different areas of medicine that are helping doctors with diagnoses, and it's you're seeing AI being used for weather prediction, and you know, I have a Word document where I keep track of different applications. It's almost every area that you can think of, manufacturing and sports and predictions. And it's being used everywhere.
So, but the premise of your book is, and I don't want to, because I have not read the book yet, but it's really that we shouldn't be as afraid as we are, but should we be worried at all? Or is it, it's not that we shouldn't be worried at all, is it?
No, there are some very... The premise of my book is there are some really big things that we should be worried about, and the biggest of which is self-driving cars. But self-driving cars, discrimination, privacy, military use are all issues we should be worried about, and we can't focus on those things if we keep worrying about Westworld androids and the Terminator, which will exterminate us all.
I guess I'm really lucky, or maybe I'm really smart, but I think probably more lucky that I stopped watching television. I took television out of my house 13 years ago and haven't watched it. I've never seen Westworld. When I hear people talking about Westworld, I think of the movie that Yul Brynner was in the late 70s.
By the same time. Same idea. Yeah.
Same idea. Yeah. But I haven't had any of that influence of pop culture. Now, Lori said, I love Data on Star Trek Generation. I'm assuming Data is a robot. I don't
absolutely
know.
Data is an intelligent android like the Westworld androids. Yeah. Super intelligent android.
So from your perspective, is AI a misnomer? Because it sounds like you're saying it's really not intelligent. So artificial or not, it's not intelligent at all. It's just advanced database, data-driven responses from programmatic data-driven responses, right? So it's not really intelligence at all.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's the terminology leads to a lot of the fear, you know, calling it artificial intelligence when it
right.
There's no real intelligence there. And a lot of the terminology that's used in intelligence, you know, AI systems have imaginations. They can reason. I mean, not really.
Right. So as a scientist, and do you give any credence because scientists are the ones who came up with this idea. Now, I'm going to lead you into a place you probably thought this would never go, and I'm going back to my Sunday night program here, is that for years and years, science was very atheistic, and there's no God, and went out of their way to push science and religion further and further apart. Now, all of a sudden, scientists have found that not only is there a God, but he's a teenage kid in his mother's basement with a laptop, basically creating a matrix where we're all simulated. Do you give any credence to that at all?
You know, how would we know?
I don't know. I can't get one of the guys who authored the books to ever come on and talk to me about it. I am really curious about it. That's what I want to ask specifically. Nick Bostrom, said he might be interested when time clears up or when he has time to do it, but I haven't been able to talk to one of these experts on it, so I can't give you an answer on that. But I know they're really adamant that this is the case, that God is some computer programmer out there, which to me is mind-blowing, because I can't imagine that the thoughts we have are all part of some, because we all have individual thoughts, and my experience of reality is different than yours as a human being. So I can't imagine how that would work. But I'm not the sharpest tool in the shed to begin with.
Nick Bostrom believes that we're going to build these intelligent robots, and that's all we should, and that's what we should really be worried about.
Right. Yeah, but he also believes that, you know, we are a part of a simulation, and he's written a couple of books on that, and that, so that's where this is leading to. If he's right in the fact that this is a simulation, then it is very possible that we will see robots with that kind of intelligence flipping the scene, as it was, and making us the machines or the slaves to the machines, which is the big fear, right?
Well, if we're already in a simulation, we're already slaves to the machines. Well, we're not going to become slaves to the machines. We already are.
I get that. And that's where the theologian I had on who was talking about it said, in some respect, we already are. He brought up, you know, we create these machines to do complex tasks, but when they break down, we find we're working for them. It's almost like the story of if an alien came down and saw how human beings react now with humans following around their dog, picking up the poop and putting it in the bag, you'd be confused at who's actually the master and who's the slave there, right? It's that. Yeah, it's a little bit of that.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, my original book title had a little bit of a, maybe not theological, but philosophical bent to it. My original title for the book was "There's No Ghost in the Machine."
Oh,
and you know that was a take. That was a takeoff on a very well-known book by a philosopher named Arthur Koestler back in the 1960s, who wrote a book called "The Ghost in the Machine," discussing not so much with computers, but is there a mind separate from the body in people?
Right.
And that's a longstanding philosophical argument.
Well, and that's where this on Monday or was Tuesday, I don't know, I do so many shows. Earlier this week, when I had Pastor on, he was talking about machines can't have souls. So they you know, or spirits, as we kind of think. But at some point, because he definitely is a believer that AI will become more advanced and want to take over society. He said at some point we need to grant personhood. He was like making a political argument that we need to grant personhood to machines because so that we treat them as people even though they don't have souls. Can I get your reaction to that? And is it the first time you heard that argument?
No, absolutely not. You know, I mean, there are people pushing for those kinds of laws, and you know that would make sense if computers and robots are someday going to be intelligent. Because if they're really going to be intelligent, they're probably going to gain consciousness, and maybe we should treat them more like people and worry about their rights. You know, but I make the analogy to my golf clubs. If I hit a bad shot and I decide to wrap that golf club around the tree, you know, nobody feels bad for the golf club. And if you've got a robot that has no intelligence whatsoever, can't feel anything, can't think, can't reason, can't do any of that, why would you need laws to protect that robot?
Right. I get it. I totally understand. So in your vision of the future, that's not going to happen, so we won't need personhood.
Right.
Right.
Exactly.
You know, he's a lot younger than you and a lot younger than me, so he hasn't had the experience in but he has studied, he has dedicated his life since a teenager to studying AI and this kind of stuff, even though he's a theologian. And he you know, what we call computer artificial intelligence is something that he's really studied a lot and got his PhD as well. But he believes that at some point there will be the kind of things that we see in Lost in Space or in television and movies where humanoid robots that, and I guess when we start to see things like on the internet where advertisements for the robot that Japan has come up with, the household butler type thing that interacts with you, gets to know, it has it was basically what I described earlier. A lot of those complex data-driven tasks into one thing that looks like sort of humanoid. And yeah. So that feeds into our fear of where this might go, but that's the wrong place to be afraid. I think you pointed out self-driving cars, self-flying airplanes should scare the hell out of us more than a robot like that, right?
Absolutely. I mean, self-driving cars, everybody assumes that, you know, self-driving cars, computers can process much faster than people. They don't get drunk. They don't get tired. So why wouldn't a self-driving car be a better driver, be a safer driver than a human? And in fact, you know, what I find scary about that is that the National Highway and Transportation Safety Authority has essentially taken that position. You know, they require for everything else in a car, you have to prove that the brakes are going to work. Show me the safety data, you know. But for the self-driving capabilities, you know, they're going to be safer than people. So let's get them out there. And we don't know how to test them. So let's not even bother to try to test them. Let's just put them out there. And the problem is that that car, there's no self-driving car that's ever going to be able to think or reason. And a lot of human driving is thinking and reasoning. You know, we see a ball bounce across the street. We look for the child running after it. You know, we see somebody weaving in their lane and we say, oh, I wonder if they're drunk. How am I going to make sure I don't get into an accident with them?
Right. And,
you know, there are, if you think about driving, everybody's got a story about driving that's different. You know, if there are 1.4 billion drivers in the world, if there are 1.4 billion different situations that people had to think and reason their way out of, how are we ever going to build a car that can do that?
Right. Yeah. And I think I bring this up a lot. It's almost like a lot of scientists just ignore the lessons that, from horror movies and sci-fi horror and stuff like that, across the board in experimentation and stuff. But with respect to that driving, you're right. A human, and this is might be an abstract, but a human can decide if there are two objects in front of you that you might hit, one is a dog and one is a human, most human drivers anyway would opt to hit the dog rather than the human, you know, make an adjustment to hit one or the other. A computer is not going to do that, right? It's just going to say there's an obstacle in front of me. I'm going to try to avoid both, but it's not going to be able to choose which is the moral right thing to do in that moment.
Yeah.
Right?
Although, you know, you can program for every type of object that you can recognize.
Yeah, yeah.
You can give it a list that says, most important, don't hit babies.
Right.
Next, don't hit adults. You know, next, don't hit dogs. You know, so you can program that one example. But even more importantly, have you ever been faced with that dilemma of what to kill in a car? Most people haven't.
I actually have, but it wasn't a human. It was two different animals. And different animals, yeah. Not which one I killed, which one I was going to hit. And I hit the deer, and the deer didn't even, because of the way cars are built these days, my car is kind of like, it's not even aluminum. It's like this really soft plastic. The deer kind of looked at me like, that's all you got. Yeah. It stood there, and it wasn't even hurt at all. So, but I've had to make that decision. But even more important than that decision at all, I have turned on my computer that worked fine yesterday or the next day, did nothing on my own, and found big problems with the way it was functioning and working. And so that point, you know, if we're going to have self-driving cars, they should be checked out by a computer programmer every single day, because you can turn it off and turn it on tomorrow and things will go wrong for no reason sometimes.
Even worse, you know, I have a Tesla. And I actually love the Tesla, even though it's so far from real self-driving. But, you know, about every 2 weeks or maybe every month, I get an over-the-air update, which changes the way something works.
Right. And when we've had updates, even on your phone, you can see that sometimes software developers put out updates before they've been thoroughly vetted and tested, and they end up with bugs, which is why we have so many frequent updates. So that's something that needs to be taken into account with self-driving anything and drones and all that stuff too as well, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, Tesla claims it tests much better than your typical software, but you never know. I mean, I had, and most of the updates, I have to admit, every update except one has been something that I actually like in the car. You know, it's better. The screen shows, you know, maybe the cones on the side of the road. And I mean, it's little stuff that I like, but a couple of months ago, I turned on the car and all of a sudden I was no longer able to use my voice to say, you know, call Matt.
Wow.
The microphone was gone. Absolutely gone. It's still gone.
Wow. Was that an intentional upgrade or a mistake in the programming?
I assumed it was a mistake and that it would come back, you know, but there've been, you know, three or four updates since then and it hasn't come back.
So the long and short of it, really for people is not to be alarmed or overreacting to the Hollywood exaggerated versions of humanoid robots, but to be paying attention to more things that are much more mundane, like drones or automatic big machines that can cause harm, that are being driven by computers, not necessarily with intelligence, but with by databases, of course. But that's where the concern should be, rather than this idea that how it's going to lock us out of the spaceship. Yeah. Do I sum it up correctly?
Absolutely. And it's, you know, in addition to that, you know, last year, a guy named Robert Williams, who lived in the Detroit suburb, had a knock on his door, and the police came and locked him up and kept him in jail overnight. Why? A facial recognition program had matched his face to a bank robber's face, even though it was a grainy photo of the bank robber. And facial recognition is notorious for being discriminatory. It's much more likely to make a mistake with a minority, and Robert Williams is African-American, than it is with a white male. And that's scary. And it's not because the programmers are discriminatory. It's because, again, you start with a database, and that database has images of people, millions of images of people. Well, all the early facial recognition systems used databases that are mostly pictures of white males.
Right.
So it doesn't work as well for minorities. So they're more likely to get, you know, collared for a crime they didn't commit. So now companies are pulling back all their facial recognition programs and rebuilding them with databases that aren't discriminatory.
Hmm. What has been the response to your book from the academics and people in the field? Most people agree with you and think that this book needs to be read by lawmakers and people like that, or the majority of people are on the side of AI and what we think of our imaginary AI future is more likely to happen? Where are people lying with in response to your book?
You know, I've gotten all 5-star reviews on Amazon, which doesn't necessarily mean that everybody agrees with me.
Right. Maybe it means it's a well-written book.
I mean, I've gotten good reviews. I've gotten, you know, good stories on Forbes and, a bunch of review sites. I don't know that academics actually disagree with me, although they may think that they may figure it out faster than I think they're going to figure it out. But, you know, it's something that's difficult for academics to talk about because, I mean, let's face it, you know, you've got AI people who are making $1 million-plus salaries at a lot of companies.
Right. There's an incentive on the part of academics and scientists to want to push this forward. So they're not going to necessarily be unbiased. It's basically the point there, right?
Right. And I'm not the first. I'm not the first one to, make an argument like this.
Why do you think? Is it just because of pop culture that this, because I'm still on the with all the things in taken into account, I think probably 100 years from now, there will be something with real intelligence, but I don't know. I'm not the sharpest, and I haven't studied this stuff my whole life, but I see I'm carrying around a television studio now, which was just like science fantasy when I was a kid. Not just a television studio; it's everything I ever need to do is here. So, to me, that suggests that technology is moving at such a rapid pace. In my lifetime, I never thought I would see that. And that's 12 years old now.
Yeah, no, I feel the same. I feel the same way.
Yeah,
but you know, but there are some things that are just much, much harder problems than everything else. I mean, just, you know, a lot of people think that in order to get to really intelligent computers, you have to understand how the brain works.
Right.
And, you know, some researchers will tell you that we've made a lot of progress in the last 10, 20 years understanding how the brain works. But, you know, we really still have very little idea of how the brain works. So, I'll tell you a story. In 1980, I was part of an academic debate about how visual images are represented in the brain. You know, so if I ask you the question, "What shape are German Shepherd's ears?" Give me the answer and tell me how you got that answer.
What shape is a German Shepherd?
Yeah, German Shepherd's ears.
I don't know what shape it is. I don't know. Well,
so most people would say, okay, they're pointy. And I figured that out by I visualized the German Shepherd and kind of traced up the body to the head right. And then to the ears. And I kind of saw in my mind's eye that they're pointed.
Okay.
So, you know, that set off, you know, a big academic debate, which, you know, dozens and dozens of academics participated in, you know, over many years. Half said, yeah, in the brain, you know, there's something analog like a picture that has, you know, that has dimensionality. And other people said, no, it's just a list of facts. And we fool ourselves into thinking that there's a picture there. And, you know, I look back at the debate now and it seems like arguing about how many angels on the head of a pin.
Right.
But some of the best minds were part of that debate. You know, Steven Pinker, who has written some of the, you know, best books on the psychology of mind, and Jeffrey Hinton, who's considered the father of modern AI, and a bunch of others. And my point is, with all those great minds, we still don't know the answer.
Right. Well, you used a couple of different words there, and I think it's important to point out, and what I think it illustrates the point you're making, is that you use the word mind, but you also use the word brain. I think we know how the brain works, which is basically a database. Mind, consciousness, and the ability to have feeling, empathy, and all those things are part of mind, not necessarily, I mean, of course, it's all controlled by the brain, but all those things are not necessarily brain function. They're mind function, and their mind is not necessarily brain. They're two different things.
Well, that goes back to that whole philosophical argument. Is there anything that's mind that's not brain?
Right.
We don't know the answer to that one either, even though it's been debated for 300 years.
Right. And that was my argument earlier this week about we can teach machines and program machines to do lots of things, but feeling and reasoning and mindfulness is something that's uniquely part of the human brain, I think, and I don't see that ever happening. But again, you're right, you can never say never, but I just can't imagine it. That's not even in my imagination. I can't imagine a machine feeling something, having emotion, empathy, all those kinds of things that we associate with mindfulness rather than right. brain function. So
right. I mean, I can't either, but I can't imagine machines really understanding language either.
Yeah, yeah. I guess they do in some way. But again, it's all database driven, which is a part of, I think my big takeaway from this is a lot of the fear is because of the unknown, people who don't really look under the hood of computers or machines ever. So we just, all we know is the depiction that pop culture gives us of this humanoid thing that becomes like a human, even though it's made out of machine, metal, whatever we created out of. So that's where the fear comes from, right?
Exactly. That's exactly right. And you know, if you're still worried about it, you know, read my book, and hopefully I'll convince you that you don't need to worry about it.
Well, I'm convinced that I don't need to worry about it. But again, I'm sure I'll be long gone. We'll all be long gone before it ever happens. But if you have kids, grandkids, maybe you should be concerned about some aspects of where we're going with technology in the future. Not necessarily the ones that we conjure up in our minds. And this has always been the case with humanity. The future that we fear is not necessarily the future we should fear. The things that end up being the real problems for us are things we never thought about, never considered in our advancement in technology and all that stuff. Not the things that we imagine and put into movies and books and stuff for dramatic effect, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Right, exactly.
Great stuff. And I appreciate you coming by. And and sharing your insight with us. Again, the book is called Evil Robots, Killer Computers, and Other Myths, The Truth About AI and the Future of Humanity. It's available at AIperspectives.com. My guest today has been Stephen Shwartz. Thank you so much for this information. I just have one more question. Are you optimistic that your insights are going and the information you lay out in the book and your perspective on it are going to make a difference among the people who need to hear it?
I'm hopeful it'll make a difference with some people. Whether it'll be widespread, not so optimistic.
Okay. Well, great. Thank you for coming by today. And if you ever have anything more to say about this or any other subject, please come back and share your information with us, because this has been interesting and stimulating for me. I hope I learned something today. But thank you for coming. I wish you great success, and bye for now.
Thank you, Matt. I really enjoyed it, and thanks for having me.
Bye. Stephen Shwartz, folks. Again, the book is Evil Robots, Kill Computers, and Other Myths. It's available at AIperspectives.com. Hope you enjoyed this program. Hope you got something out of it. Hope you learned something today. Hope if you were worried about the robot takeover of the planet, your mind has put at ease a little bit. I think most people are still going to be nervous. I'm convinced that by what he says about where what real intelligence looks like and the difference between what we see in data-driven tasks and real intelligence. I'm convinced that that's a good argument for now. What the future holds, I'm still on the fence about that. But again, I don't think I'll be around for it. Anyway, I'd love to hear your thoughts and comments. Write to me at info@minddogtv.com and let me know what you thought about today's program. I hope you share it with other people. And tonight at 8 p.m., my friend Morgan Roberts will be joining me for just a casual conversation, catching up with an old friend. So, but it will be an interesting program. I guarantee you that. Her dad, Jimmy Roberts, has been a frequent guest on the program, and he's the guy who informed us about the past and future of Mars exploration and what it means to us. So, and Morgan is a lovely, lovely young lady who kind of introduced me to her dad. It's a nice way to end a week for me. I don't have any shows this weekend because I'll be out performing with the band. So until 8 p.m. tonight, I'm Matt Knappel for the Mind Dog TV podcast. Thanks for coming. Have a great night.